Good evening, this is Viewpoint. I'm Zaka Jacob. The arrest of Umar Gautam and Jahangir Alam, both of whom were allegedly running a multi-city, multi-country forced conversion racket, has now opened a can of worms. The Uttar Pradesh ATS says, prima facie, they believe there is huge amounts of money laundering involved. And now, the Enforcement Directorate has also registered a case. Now, most interestingly, the name of fugitive preacher Zakir Naik has also come to the fore. What did his organization and what did he individually have to do with these two alleged force converters? But does this also point to a larger conspiracy coming as it does just months ahead of the UP elections? First the story, and then we'll go across to our panelists.
On Monday, the 21st of June, Uttar Pradesh's anti-terrorism squad came forward with a sensational expose. It claimed to have busted what it called was the biggest organized religious conversion racket. And these were the kingpins. Qazi Jahangir Alam and Muhammad Umar Gautam, both preachers and both residents of Jamia Nagar in New Delhi. The allegation? Both were using foreign funds and Islamic organizations to push a pan-India conversion drive.
Unke saath jo documents mile hain. तो ये तो स्पष्ट है कि धर्मांतरण तो हुआ है और उसमें फंडिंग भी जो है कंफर्म हो रही है. जो हमारी एजेंसीज हैं वो ये देख रही हैं कि क्या हवाला से कोई ट्रांजैक्शन तो नहीं हुआ.
हवाला की बात सामने आ रही सर
जी, ये संभव है कि हवाला की ट्रांजैक्शंस तो नहीं है.
अकॉर्डिंग टू द ATS, द टू स्पेशली टारगेटेड द वल्नरेबल वुमेन एंड चिल्ड्रन हु हैड बीन अबैंडनड और वर इन डायर नीड ऑफ मनी. The idea was to convert, radicalize, and ultimately use them to create communal unrest.
देखिए मेरे बेटे का ब्रेन वॉश करके उसका धर्म परिवर्तन किया गया है. मेरे को बोलता सुनता है नहीं, गुंगा बेरा है तो इशारों में बात करता है. तो उसने ठा के एक एफडी उड़ाते पकड़ा दे, उसमें देखा था, उसमें लिखा था कि मनु यादव पिता का नाम है राजी यादव और धर्म हिंदू कन्वर्जन किया नाम मनु यादव से अब्दुल मनन कर दिया.
In their questioning, it has emerged that Umar Gautam was himself a recent convert to Islam.
मैंने जो सोचा नहीं था कभी.
In this video, he can be heard proudly listing his achievements.
मैंने कभी तसव्वुर नहीं किया था, लेकिन अल्हम्दुलिल्लाह उस यूनिवर्सिटी में अल्लाह ने ये तौफीक दी और फिर मैंने अपने दोस्तों को दावत दी तो उसी यूनिवर्सिटी में अल्हम्दुलिल्लाह 7 लोगों ने इस्लाम की गवाही दी. अल्हम्दुलिल्लाह इस सेंटर में 1000 से ज्यादा लोगों के लीगल डॉक्यूमेंटेशन की फॉर्मेलिटीज पूरी की गई हैं.
The Enforcement Directorate has filed a money laundering case. The agency is probing how the clerics received funds and the possible role of fugitive Islamic preacher Zakir Naik.
ये तो कांग्रेस और उनके समर्थित दलों का पाला हुआ कहीं ना कहीं प्यादा था और इसी को पाल पोस कर उन्होंने बड़ा किया था और उससे निकले हुए ये रूट हैं जो आज धर्म परिवर्तन की बातें आ रही हैं, धर्मांतरण कराते हुए लोग मिल रहे हैं, ये इनके कनेक्शन सीधे उसी से जुड़ते हैं.
ये जो एलिगेशन किए जा रहे हैं कि वो इस कन्वर्जन के पीछे है, ये एलिगेशन बिल्कुल गलत है. These allegations are false and baseless. He has got nothing to do with all these alleged conversions that are being spoken about or the allegations that have been made.
The Uttar Pradesh government claims the two preachers have converted 1,000 people to Islam. But the timing of this big operation is being questioned, given that it comes ahead of the 2022 elections, where polarization, as always, will be the dominant theme.
All right, joining us on the talking point, Ghanshyam Tiwari, spokesperson of Samajwadi Party, Anila Singh, spokesperson of the BJP, and Ratan Sharda is author and RSS sympathizer. Thanks very much for speaking with us. Ghanshyam Tiwari, I'll start with you. One of the things that your party has been questioning is the timing, 6 months before the UP Assembly elections. But aside of the timing, are you in agreement that there needs to be a probe to find out if there is an organized conversion racket going on in UP?
Zaka, in February 2021, the central government told the parliament in Lok Sabha that there is no plan to bring an anti-conversion law across the country. The states can deal with it and it was not a high risk. This is the central government just this year. Now, take back the UP government and the entire BJP establishment and the media that favors it, the way they haunted Tablighi Jamaat. Then look at Adityanath, the way he, through horrific hate preaching, people like him climb the ladders of politics and eventually become chief ministers, terrorize people in the states. Siddiqui Kappan, a journalist, a politician is speaking for journalists, is in jail. His mother passes away, no empathy. We have seen a state whose model is terror and mistrust. So I do not trust anything that this UP police with Hathras on its hands, Kanpur kidnappings on its hands, and several other such situations on its hands. And this government, which has made hate a state policy objective,
But Mr. Tiwari, surely you will also agree to the fact, sir, you will also agree to the fact that this whole thing, came to light after that video surfaced. Surely it's not your point that the video was also leaked by the UP police. Are you saying that?
I'm saying that this state, who has failed lakhs of people who have died, people are angry. They have to depend on propaganda, which is their core thing. So any stray crime anywhere will be created in a way that that propaganda can be fulfilled.
Okay.
Propaganda is the essence of Bharatiya Janata Party leading into election.
Anila Singh, please respond. How is it that 6 months before the elections this has happened? Ghanshyam Tiwari saying this is propaganda. This is just to, you know, shore up the Yogi Adityanath government, which seems to be otherwise beset with both internal and external problems. Anila Singh.
Zaka, I'm not at all surprised the language which Mr. Tiwari is using right now. This is so hateful, hurtful also. Hurtful because right now Chief Minister is a yogi and he is saying that Uttar Pradesh has become a terror state. So I don't know from where he has got this word, because in my Sanskriti, in Bharatiya Sanskriti, a yogi cannot be a terrorist. So when he says it is a terror state, then he has to define how. Secondly, he's talking about Kanpur kidnappings. I don't know which case was that. Kanpur kidnappings, I have never heard of. So this shows that how fake news are being made up by Samajwadi Party just to defame our government, Bharatiya Janata Party government here. A political party who has made people vaccinophobic because their leader said that we should not get Bharatiya Janata Party vaccine for us. So the political party who doesn't have any political morality is trying to preach that what is right and what is wrong.
No, but ma'am, is it the biggest issue? Is this the ma'am, is this the biggest issue 6 months before the UP elections, or are there other bread and butter issues, including, of course, the way the state is dealing with the corona situation? Shouldn't that be the biggest thing that should matter to the people and the government should be focused on?
I was about to come to this point only. When Mr. Tiwari blames us that elections are around the corner, that is why they have come up with this case. So I have to ask him, when Yogi government brought this law against conversion, so yeah, elections were not around the corner. When Yogi government brought the law on taking the compensation of from the people who damaged private and public property, elections were not around the corner. So we had been doing, we are doing, and we will be doing all those things by which we think that it can be threat to society. And if we talk about bread and butter, let me tell Mr. Tiwari, Mr. Tiwari, when you left Uttar Pradesh 2017, our economy was just 10.20. And now it is almost double, more than double, I can say so. And in many other things, in ease of doing business, we are standing on second position. So I have to tell here that these are very trying times. So you cannot compare the normal times with these trying times.
Okay, Ghanshyam Tiwari, please respond 30 seconds and then I'll go to Ratan Sharda after that. Ghanshyam
very
Tiwari.
Very respectfully, two quick points. Kidnapped UP man, killed 4 cops, including IPS officers, suspended. This is the Kanpur Varra case of Sanjit Yadav. It is not right for Anila Singh to call it as a fake news. A man died and their police was caught on wrong foot and every footing. Second, that I agree with Anila Singh finally that their government did not depend on elections to bring out these laws which become a framework of terrorizing people. This is exactly what we are saying. We are saying the same thing. In 4.5 years, they have only created frameworks of terrorizing people. Anandibeen Patel, honorable governor of Uttar Pradesh, said that if they are bringing love jihad law, they would have done any survey. Show me the survey. Here is a government that makes propaganda the basis, not the data. They make propaganda the basis of a law. Law is not debated in assembly. Data is not presented, and yet governor is missed.
Let me get Ratan Sharda into the discussion. Ratan Sharda, ma'am, I'll come back to you. Ratan Sharda, the point is the constitution gives the right to practice, preach and propagate a religion of one's choice. But the problem is when it becomes forced, when it's done through inducement, when it's done through some kind of intimidation tactics. The question though is the UP police, the UP ATS believes that this was a much larger racket. Why should we believe that 6 months as it does coming before the elections?
See, first of all, to say that any incident, any inquiry, any problem is linked to the date or period or timing is the tamest excuse anybody can make. Because in India, every 6 months, every 4 months, there is an election. So this kind of tame excuse don't work. Secondly, Dr. Ambedkar said years back that conversion denationalizes the people, so he did not choose Islam or Christianity. He chose Bodha Dharma. So one should understand that. The language of the SP representative is so contemptuous about the Hindus. What is Hindus' crime? They are tolerant. They respect other religion. So Maulana, whose video he very boastfully, Maulana released, he said, ye bada humko aaram se baat karte hai, humari izzat karte hai, uska fayda utha ke humko convert karte hai. Also, the conversion laws were brought in by, first of all, by Madhya Pradesh Congress government. Most of the state governments that brought in anti-conversion law, Congress governments, not BJP or Jansang governments of those time. Mm-hmm. And this is required because both the religions, whether primary religions, Islam or Christianity, use this goodwill of the Hindus and they convert and create problem. Whole of Northeast was burning because of church backing of terrorists. Now all these people who are talking about timing, will they agree that the people who are converted went to ISIS, they went to Syria, they became human bombs, many want to come back now?
Yeah.
So this, the problem is that we create this all the hullabaloo in the name of timing, in the name of all this, but I am not saying what ATS will do.
No, I think that point that you raised about ISIS was a fair one. There were at least a dozen cases.
Zaka, is exclusivism, where you create hate for the other religion and convert people. I have no problem with the conversion per se, but when you ask them to break the idols, when the murtis, when you ask them to burn other copies and they say this is imperial religion, tum sinful ho, they must be converted to save your soul.
Okay.
My problem with that particular formulation.
Okay, got that. Ghanshyam Tiwari, but please respond on the ISIS point. There were, including from Uttar Pradesh, I think a large number of them were from Kerala and Maharashtra, etc. But there were cases from Uttar Pradesh also of people, recent converts who took up this ISIS philosophy, went to Afghanistan, went to Syria to fight. Now many of them are wanting to come back. So those cases have also happened.
We have Aditya Nath as Chief Minister of Uttar Pradesh. Did he preach harmony and become Chief Minister? Did he have love crimes or hate crimes? Please do not interrupt. Please do not interrupt. This is the hateful language that they use.
Don't keep on saying.
Please do not interrupt. Debates are not, do not happen like this.
You deviate debates.
Sir, let him respond, sir. Let him respond. I've asked him a question. Let him respond. Mr. Tiwari, and also stick to the issue. Answer the question that I've asked you, sir, please.
Well, when he said that I am anti-Hindu or my party is anti-Hindu, I want to tell him that a young man who was highly educated in his time was brainwashed and he assassinated Mahatma Gandhi. Ratan Sharda is a sharp intellectual with same mindset. So I'm not surprised that he uses his platform to brand me anti-Hindu. So
Mr. Tiwari, stick to the issue, sir. Let's stick to the issue. The conversion racket that is happening allegedly in Uttar Pradesh.
Yes.
Why are you loath to even having an inquiry into it? That's the question.
The greatest racket in Uttar Pradesh is a government who came to power, speaking of Shamshan Kabristan, gave no development, only demonstrated the development that we did, and is now highly aggressive to get back to the Shamshan Kabristan agenda because they have nothing to show.
No, so if they have nothing
election
to show for, people will vote them out. No, if they have
There's
nothing
no
to show for, people
on
will vote them out.
The discussion is only on hateful politics, and that is what BJP is going to champion in
the
run-up.
So if as you say, they have nothing to show for, and I'll ask Anila Singh this, if they have nothing to show for, and history has shown that Indian voters are very unforgiving of governments who have nothing to show for, so if, as what you say, they have nothing to show for, people will vote that government out in 6 months. But Anila Singh, quickly respond. Mr. Tiwari saying you have nothing to show for, it's only peddling hate, and that's how you came to power, and that's how you intend to stay in power in Uttar Pradesh. Quickly, ma'am.
I'll make three quick points here. First of all, he mentioned about love jihad. So let me tell Mr. Tiwari, a law is made and there is absolutely no questions about it. If somebody is going to be trapped in love jihad, action will be taken because there is a proper procedure to get married. So I am very clear about it. If you want to politicize it, you are more than welcome to do it. Secondly, you are saying that we are into hateful politics, we are here to polarize. Then I have to ask him a simple question. What that Umed Pehlwan was doing? He was your worker and he got this whole fabricated story, a loony story. You wanted some sort of communal tension in our Uttar Pradesh, especially in Western UP. So you are the person who wants to get Hindu-Muslim done in UP. And finally, let me say one thing here, Mr. Tiwari, you just now mentioned about Kabristan and Shamshan. I was surprised, I was shocked when I saw the pictures of only Shamshans on media, in print media, nationally, internationally. No picture of Kabristan. So this virus knew that it has to infect Hindus, not Muslims. So nobody from Muslims died, only Hindus died. You wanted to portray that this government cannot protect, cannot support Hindus. Very bad government, because Hindus have faith in us, have trust in us. You want to polarize everything. So whether we talk about the corona time, whether we talk about the regular time, here is Yogi Adityanath ji, who has been working day and day out.
I'll give you the final word. Many are also saying that this is a whole veneer. It covers up whatever internal troubles Yogi Adityanath and the UP BJP are facing, which we've seen over the last 2-3 weeks, the series of meetings and so on. So this is a veneer. It covers all of that going into the elections. Please respond.
See, Mr. Tiwari seems not to be reading newspaper or watching the social media or watching the news. Every day there is news of love jihad by cheating women and converting them or forcing them to convert or killing them. Today there is a case of Kerala where the other way around, a Hindu was in love with a Muslim woman. He was killed. So you can't deny this intolerance, point one. Point two, he talked about Godse. If Hindus were to become as intolerant as other religions, you can understand where India will be. So let us not try to provoke and instigate people.
Is that a threat?
Swami Shraddhanand was, can you keep quiet now? Swami Shraddhanand was killed by Abdul Rashid for getting people reconverted to Hinduism. This was much before Godse. And he was felicitated by the Muslims, and also Gandhiji said, he's like my brother. So if Swami Shraddhanand's killing is justified, then what are you talking about? Gandhiji killing is contemptible.
Okay. I'm out of time. I want to thank Ratan Sharda, Ghanshyam Tiwari, Anila Singh for joining us. We'll see if this becomes the biggest talking point in the run-up to the UP elections or other bread and butter issues. We'll see how that story plays out. Meanwhile, the other big story, of course, is the rise of Delta Plus cases. There are now 40 cases officially across the country, and the government today announced that there are 48 cases of the new mutant, the new strain Delta Plus across the country. The big question, though, is whether this new and perhaps slightly more transmissible, slightly more virulent strain, could it lead to a third wave in the country? Joining me now is Dr. Anurag Agarwal. He's the director of the Institute of Genomics and the Integrative Biology associated with CSIR. Thank you very much, Dr. Agarwal. What is the genome sequencing data around Delta Plus? What is the information that you can share with us, and why has it been categorized as a variant of concern?
So, first of all, the easiest answer is, why are we calling Delta Plus a variant of concern? To start this, we must point out, what is Delta Plus? The plus only stands for one thing. It is the Delta strain, Delta variant, in which additional mutations have been acquired. So Delta, with any new mutations which may or look significant, is basically referred to in short form as Delta plus that mutation, which has become shortened to Delta plus. The correct name for what we are really talking about for India is AY.1 and AY.2. And these basically are the K417N mutation, which is a mutation thought to be of importance because it has been seen in other variants of concern, beta and gamma. Mm-hmm. So when it appears in Delta, it looks important and worth investigating. The reason to call it a VOC is very simple. All Deltas are VOC. Delta plus K417N is still Delta, and Delta is a VOC. So therefore, by definition, Delta plus is also a VOC. And I think that has kind of got lost in the communication. And while it is there in the press brief, I believe that the government released, that all Delta sublineages are variants of concern, I think in the speaking out of it, it may not have become that clear.
Okay.
So the data that leads us to call it a VOC is the Delta data, not Delta plus data, not AV1 data, not AY.1 data, not AY.2 data. It is simply that data.
Okay.
The total amount of data we have for AY.1 and 2 is too small, really, 40 cases, to really make any conclusive things. There are three things we look for.
Okay.
One, is it spreading any faster? The short answer to that is, it is spreading as fast as Delta, no more, no less, which is being keeping pace with Delta. It is not being wiped out by Delta. Most mutations, if they're not fit, will be wiped out by the parent strain. Mm-hmm. Number two is it creating more severe disease? No evidence of that yet. Number three is, is it leading to more immune escape, breakthroughs in vaccinated people? We have seen a few cases in vaccinated people, but then we've also seen a few cases of simple Delta in vaccinated people. So at this moment, while we are looking for it in terms of ability to escape immunity, it is not something that we can say is more or less than the original Delta.
How?
So it's primarily a VOC because it's Delta, because it's acquired a new mutation seen in beta and gamma. That mutation is of concern because it reduces antibody binding. And therefore, we are looking specifically for increased immune escape as we investigate it further.
How real, though, Dr. Agarwal, is the fear that Delta Plus could potentially lead to a third wave in India? We're already seeing cases of Delta Plus in Maharashtra, Kerala, I think about half a dozen states. For the last two or three days, Maharashtra numbers are showing a slight upward trend. So how real is the fear that Delta Plus could lead to a third wave in the country?
I'm going to digress slightly on my answer by saying the second wave has not ended. So minor ups and downs that we will see right now are not the third wave. They are the fat tail of a second wave, with different regions being affected differently. And Delta in itself is sufficient to quickly increase cases wherever public protection for themselves drops. Right now, when I see changes in cases with Delta still circulating, probably outside the cities, a significant number of people who are still unexposed, I always think in terms of, am I looking at a continuation of a second wave? In fact, a bounce of the second wave. I'm not even thinking of which variant is going to create the third wave. Now, generally, to create a massive wave like we saw in the second wave, you need three things. You need immunity of the people to be going down.
Yeah.
That takes time. You need the new variants or new lineages that are coming in to be substantially different from previous ones so that they can escape the diminishing immunity easily. And number three, you need public behavior that allows the virus to spread easily. Now, two of these three conditions are not yet met. A, the immunity of people, massive number of people in cities who recently got infected is relatively fresh. And at least Delta Plus, it has only one, not super critical mutation, but an important mutation. But fundamentally, the virus is similar to Kappa and Delta. So you would not expect it to be so different that it'll immediately go and create a massive third wave.
All right.
So I expect it could contribute to small bounces of the second wave, but no. I think the fear that seems to have taken over the discourse of the Delta Plus variant creating a massive third wave immediately is the wrong one. I am as concerned as Dr. Guleri is about the current wave not having ended and there being plenty of parts of India where if we are not careful, we will see cases go up again.
All right.
I am.
Dr. Agarwal, thank you so much for speaking with us on CNN News 18 and very succinctly explaining the difference between Delta and Delta Plus and why we should be paying as much attention to Delta, as you called it, the fat tail of a second wave, as we are paying now to Delta Plus. That's a wrap. I'll catch you again at 9 o'clock with Brass Tacks. On the other side, Shivani will join you.